Hello and welcome. Hi, I'm Dave. This tutorial is part of a Node.js, Express, and now MongoDB for Beginners tutorial series. I'll put a link to the full playlist in the description below. MongoDB is the M in the MERN stack. It represents the database in the stack. The front-end application of the MERN stack is handled by React. Along with Node.js and Express, MongoDB completes the back-end REST API. Traditional SQL databases are built in a relational structure. Related tables reference each other with joins as data is queried. These relational tables also normalize the data. That means data is not duplicated in the tables. That's the DRY principle, which stands for don't repeat yourself, and that's applied to the structure. However, with NoSQL databases like MongoDB, you can throw all of that out. MongoDB stores data in collections. The individual records in the collections are called documents. The documents have a key value structure and look a lot like JSON. A collection holds all of the data about a user, for example, instead of breaking it into related tables. And likewise, duplicating and distributing the data where deemed necessary in a NoSQL structure is permitted. So why choose NoSQL databases? And what are the advantages of using MongoDB? Performance is key. The speed at which a collection is queried is very fast. Flexibility. It's very easy to make structural changes like adding a new field without wreaking havoc in your total structure. It is much like adding a new property to an object. Scalability. NoSQL can support large databases with high request rates at a very low latency. And finally, usability. As you'll see today, we can get up and running with MongoDB in the cloud very fast. Let's get started by going to mongodb.com. Okay, we're at mongodb.com, and I already have an account, so I'm going to choose sign in. If you don't have an account, you'll want to sign up for a free account, so you can just click try free. I'm going to click sign in, and then it will take me to a page that probably uses my Google ID or allows me to log in with an email address. Yes, there it is. So you get those options. I'm going to log in with my Google email address or my Google account, and then we'll meet back up after you have your account or you've signed into your account. Okay, I'm signed into my account and I'm on the projects page where I can create a new project. And you see, I already have one project here. Now, if you're not on this page, once you're signed in, just click the little leaf in the top left and it says view the organization home, because that's where this is. So once you're there, you'll want to create a new project. And now you'll want to name the project. I'm just going to name this one Mongo Tuts, short for tutorial, and click next. And then it asks you to go ahead and set permissions or members, and it'll probably assign that to your default account to start out with. As you can see, I have project owner right here. So I'm going to click create project. With the project created, you can see I now have Mongo Tuts up here above database deployments. We need to build a database. And of course it gives you the big shiny button right in the middle to do so. So please click that. And then it gives you choices. And we're just going to go with free today. If you want to get one that you pay for, that's fine. I'm going to choose free over here on the right. And then it will say create a shared cluster. And right now, I'm just going to keep all the defaults. So free, shared, it has AWS, it has one of the USA regions for me because I'm in the US. You may want to pick a different one if you're not, and maybe it already defaults to something close to you. And then it just has these other default settings. And I'm going to go with all of that, even the default name here, cluster 0, and click create cluster at the bottom. Now it says new clusters take between 1 to 3 minutes to provision. So I'll come back when this is finished. My cluster 0 has now been created and we're given this screen. So what we want to do is click browse collections. We don't have any collections yet, so we get this and it says load a sample data set or add my own data. We're going to choose add my own data. With that, it asks for a database name and a collection name. So let's just call this CompanyDB. And then we can call the collection name, let's go with employees. And I'll just keep that all lowercase. CompanyDB is capital company and capital DB at the end. And I'll click create. And with that, Mongo has created our company DB database and our empty employees collection right here. What we should do now is concern ourselves with database access. So let's create a user that can access this new collection and database that we have. So create a database user. We click the big button that says add new database user. And then it gives us password, certificate, and all of that. We'll just stick with password. And it put in some old information for me. Let's put in something different here. Let me go with Mongo Tut once again. And then for a password, I'm just going to, and we'll go ahead and show whatever the password is. I'll go with testing 123, kind of like a mic check. Okay, so we've got Mongo Tut testing 123. I think we'll keep all of the default options here, and we want the read and write to any database. And of course, I'll come back later and delete this user, but for now, we'll use it for the tutorial, and we'll click add user. And once we have the user, we need to go back to our cluster. So let's click Mongo Tuts, and that takes us back to our cluster. And it says we are deploying your changes, current action configuring MongoDB. So I'll give this just a second, and then we're going to click connect. With the configuration now complete, let's go ahead and click the connect button. It tells us we need to set up some security. This part is required. And what we're going to do is allow access from anywhere. We don't really know where we're going to host our backend yet. So this is good for development right now until we'd actually know what IP address we had. So let's just add in the zeros. And that means it's good from anywhere. We already created a user. So now let's click choose a connection method. And we're going to connect our application. This gives us a connection string, and this is what we want. Notice it's already put in the Mongo Tut user I created. Now I'm going to have to put in the password, including getting rid of the less than and greater than around the password. And then also I need to replace my first database with the company DB, which was the name we gave the database. So I'm going to copy this. And we're ready to close out of this now and open up Visual Studio Code. We're going to start with the code repository from the last tutorial in the Node.js and Express and now MongoDB series. But if you don't have it, you should be able to easily follow along without it, or you can download or clone the starter source code from the link that I'm providing in the description below. So let's get started by going to our .env file. And inside the .env file, it looks like I need to go to the end of the line and hit return. So we have another line. I'm going to create a database underscore URI and set it equal to our connection string. But now we just need to replace a few things in the connection string. And I'm going to press Alt Z here. I'm using Windows and it will wrap the code in Visual Studio Code. It may be different for you on Mac or Linux if you have those. Okay, so we're replacing the password. And if you remember, I put in testing lowercase 123. And then instead of my first database, we named the database company DB. And now we can save this file because we're using the process.env to pull this value out when we need it to connect. And speaking of .env, we actually put it in about three different files before, and really we could have just put it at the beginning of the project. It's not like when we require other things like the JWT here that need to go in individual files as they're needed. This can just go at the beginning of the server.js. So I'm going to pull it out of our middleware verify JWT.js file and save that. And I believe it's in a couple of controllers that we can remove it from as well. But in the server.js file, I'm going to put it at the very top. You just want it in there as soon as you can get it. And we'll save it. And now I believe, let's check these controllers real quick. Is it in the auth controller? Yes, it is. We can remove that. And it's in one other controller, if I remember right. Not the logout controller. See if it's the refresh controller. There it is. And we can remove it from that as well. And I think that will take care of it. So let's close out of the controllers. I didn't save the auth controller. Need to do that too. Okay, close out of those. And we're going to do some work here in the server. Well, really, before we do anything in the server, we need to go to package.json because we're going to install Mongoose. And I'm going to press Control and the back tick. You can also go to the terminal window or menu to open a new terminal window. And here, we need to install the Mongoose package. So it's npm I Mongoose and return. Now, Mongoose.js is a library that makes working with Mongo much easier, kind of like you could consider React makes working with JavaScript easier than vanilla JavaScript. It's just a helpful library. So let's take a look at their page real quick. It's mongoose, there we go, js.com. We bring up that page and you can see it says an elegant MongoDB object modeling for Node.js. Perfect, exactly what we need. And it has some great documentation as well. So we can refer to this as we go. Today we'll be working with a connection. Let's go back to VS Code and see if our package installed. It looks like it has, so let's check our dependencies. And we see Mongoose listed right here on line 20. So we are ready to begin working with Mongoose. So now let's go to the server.js file. And underneath credentials, let's go ahead and require Mongoose. So we define const Mongoose and set it equal to require, and then we just bring in Mongoose. And save. Now after that, we need to go ahead and create a connection configuration. So as you might guess, we're going to do that in our config folder that we have up here. So I'll highlight that and click create new file, and I'm going to call this lowercase db and then uppercase con. So it's camel case really, dbcon.js. Now let's start this file by requiring Mongoose as well. So we'll once again bring in Mongoose and require Mongoose. And now we need to create a function that we're going to export, and let's call it connectDB and set this equal to an async function. Mongoose is async. Let's go try. And after try, we'll have our catch with an error block here, and we'll just console.error and pass in the error. And then up above, we need to go ahead and try to connect to Mongoose. So how we'll do that is await. We've already got async above. And then we use Mongoose and we choose connect. And from there, we need to bring in that DB URI that we defined back in our .env. So we can just refer to process.env.database_URI. And then there is an object. And what we need to do is pass in a couple of options that will just prevent warnings that we would get from MongoDB otherwise. One is use unified, if I spelled that right, topology, and we set that to true. And the other one is use new URL parser, and we'll set that to true as well. And then we should be pretty much finished, except we once again need to do module.exports, as we have many times before for functions we've created and exported. And it is connectDB, and we can save the file. With our function created, let's go back to server.js now, and we need to import that. So say const connectDB is going to equal require, and then we need to go into config, and from there we need to pull in dbcon and save. And now let's go ahead and connect to the DB the very first thing. If it fails, we don't want to listen for any other connections anyway. So this is connect to MongoDB, and all we do is call connect DB right here, and it's ready to connect. However, there is one issue to address here. So let's scroll all the way down to where our app listens for requests. Now, we don't want to listen for requests if we don't connect. And so if our connection fails for whatever reason, we need to avoid doing this. And we can do that. Let's go back to the documentation for Mongoose. And where we had connections here in the documentation, we also have connection events. And let's look, we can listen for the connected event, And there's also the open event, which is equivalent to connected. So let's go back to our code and use that. And we can do that with Mongoose, which is why we required it for this file in particular. And we'll have mongoose.connection. And then we want once instead of on, because we'll just listen for this event one time. And we'll listen for the open event. It's a little shorter to type than connected. And now we'll have an anonymous function. And inside this, we can console log first. And inside there, we'll just say connected to MongoDB. And after we've connected to MongoDB, let's just go ahead and cut and paste in our app listen. And we'll put it right there. And now we're only going to listen for requests if we have successfully connected, because that is when the open event will be emitted by the connection. And so then our console will let us know we've connected to MongoDB and we're listening for requests on whatever port. And of course, here in development, we are defaulting to port 3500 as set at the top. Okay, all of that said, I've left the terminal window open. Let's go ahead and type npm run dev. And I'll drag it up so we have a little more room, and let's see if we connect. And we're connected to MongoDB, and the server is running on port 3500. Okay, in the next tutorial, we'll create schemas and data models with Mongoose and relate that back to our MongoDB collections. Remember to keep striving for progress over perfection. And a little progress every day will go a very long way. Please give this video a like if it's helped you, and thank you for watching and subscribing. You're helping my channel grow. Have a great day, and let's write more code together very soon.